We were fortunate, I guess it was April, I want to say April 2015, to brought here poet David Meltzer. He did a workshop here, did a reading with his wife Julie Rogers. David Meltzer was a guy who was younger than the Beats. He was the youngest person that was included in Donald Allen's really influential poetry anthology. And so he's kind of like a bridge sort of character between the Beats and the poets that came after the Beats, and also a real amazing scholar of jazz and also of Jewish mysticism. So David passed away on early in the morning on December 31st, and so I wanted to dedicate tonight's reading to him and read one of his poems, because he's just one of those many people we were fortunate to have come through here. A lot of us feel like we just sort of fell in love with the guy, and Tony and I are proud to have called him a friend, and so yeah, we miss him. So I wanted to read one of his poems to you. This is, I think it's the last poem in his City Lights Pocket Poets book, which is called When I Was a Poet. It came out about a year or so ago. It's called David Dog the Lion. David Dog the Lion bounds across Brooklyn like a greyhound and monkey. Coils around the streetcar, going to the subway. There's a war going on. He paws it all down at the rugby. David Dog the Lion roller skates through Brooklyn. WW2 BMT to Coney Island. Roller racketing on boardwalk wood, ocean unfolding onto shores, Luna Park on the other side. Big smile of till you could get sucked into as into a big fish. David Dog the Lion, the monkey scrambling through cotton candy, Nathan's hot dogs jiving and thriving, and dare you to catch me on the boogie boardwalk. Over the fence onto the sand, facing the ocean, opening its brine for an epic swim to California. David Dog the Lion, unreal eel, sliming down Hollywood Boulevard, stalks stars with true unagi pizzazz. Gets snagged by PR paparazzi, put on public access TV. Need an agent to fend off offers in those hyper moments before the right one snakes into the cacophony of realism. Of fake moments, glass shards, piercing eyes, and told as history. Bleeds from tight lips, mute as memory evaporates. Each second, it's received. David Dog in Lion Country can't afford to tread lightly, nor love unconditionally. Really lost in between campfires and shadows of others who may be lions aligned in packs like we used to do before fire. David Dog the Lion looping, loping over evaporating habitats, makes eye contact with polar bears swimming into certain starvation. David Dog from the start knew a thing or two but then forgot, foraged like skinny rat through the mountains, pyramids of shyest shit crap, unused uselessness as a native in those cities. He was, after all, a New Yorker. David Dog the Lion, lost and found, red prongs sprung out, plugging and unplugging, sometimes stuck in heap holes along the road. David Dog the Lion, driven by certainty, so fractured it's kaleidoscopic, musky inside doghouse, uncertainty melts the leash at last, and again, I'm off. David Dog the Lion, the once upon a time lemming, chases cats and squirrels, but not raccoons. They're way too tough for this soft heart barker, sometimes doubts his own bark, his weave of woofs, a furry aria no one knows what to do with. Ariel Mutt, angel David Dog, bounds down the hill too fast, buckles to his knees, tearing fur and skin, sad sack mutt crumpled beneath giant redwoods. David the Dog, the Lion, wonders about his progeny displaced all over the place. Postscriptum. Wonder about dog, his name. Celebrated mystery words of English etymology, recorded first in 1050, probably born before then. Dogs and guards, guardians. David Dog the Lion, straight out of Brooklyn, now on the run from dog catcher gods on speed, with GPS tracking my pawful flight into awful laser lights. ODDL, known for fidelity, nobility, keeper of boundaries between this world and the next, guardian of the passage, guardian of the underworld, skid around cement corner, rip a hunk of hide off my bony body. David Dog, the Lion Buddha, companion of the Mother Goddess, of all huntresses, Firebringer, hits the dirt scrambling away from AK-47 bullets. Hey, I thought this was the US of A. David Dog the Lion lost in the bullet holes, like starry scars, lights out for now. We miss you, David. Now I have some good news to report. In this room on January 28th, we're going to have a book launch event for Mr. Ian Caton. He's got a, he's got a pretty great book out called The Creative Records. I'm sure he's going to tell you a little bit more about it, but I'd just like to personally invite all of you to come here 6 p.m., I believe, on the evening of January the 28th and join us for Ian's big book launch right here in this room. Please say hello to Mr. Ian Caton and congratulate him on his new book.
See this sign right here, because I mean, if you've been coming here to this reading right here, you know this isn't new information or anything like this, but having it in a sign so that it advertises and shows the world that we stand for everybody, that we include everybody depending on, you know, your religion, you know, your racial background, your sexual orientation, your gender, your ethnicity. You know, and that ethnicity and race are different are different things, and that this is a safe place right here, that no matter who you are, you're welcome, you know what I mean? And that it's in print right here. I mean, that's powerful stuff right there. Thanks. Yeah. A new piece I'm working on. Always trying to work on new stuff. I wrote this last night in a car, waiting to pick up my kid from basketball practice, and I wrote it on my telephone, and then I put it over and typed it up. And then I thought about it, and I think it's a song, but I'm not sure. So I'm putting it to some old chords that I've been working with. I've been working with these chords for about 25 years now.
Nice.
I think it'll work. It's called Certificate. Someday I'm gonna have me a certificate that says I'm Someday I'm gonna have me a certificate signed by the mayor himself. It hung right on my wall.
Still the king. There's a lot of writers
stores and everything left wing. Well, you might be published in New York, but that don't mean a fucking thing. But up here in the Northwest, no, Mike G is still the king. This part's true. Mike G is gentle and he's kind. He'll give advice for free. He'll sit through any way, reading, listening, respectively. He is the poet of steel, and he supports his community. And if there's one thing that's for certain, know that Mike G is still the king. From Bill Stafford to Gary Snyder, Amy Zimmerman and all, the poets gather round to hear Mike G, cause he stands tall.
Paper
flying everywhere.
Way to go, Mr.
Payton.
Thank
you.
Yeah.
That was
great, man.
Thank you, Payton. Come back on January 28th. So I wrote a blurb for his book, and one of the things that you need to learn if you are fortunate enough to be asked for a blurb is to, you know, make sure that the book is really good before you blurb it. So I blurbed Mr. King's book, and I blurbed Mary Slocum's book, there she is, because they're good fucking books, so come and check it out. And he's got a bunch of guests, like Tony is going to read, and let's see who else we've got coming. Nathan Tompkins will be reading, Alex Vigue, and Jennifer Robin. So come back here on January 28th and see him do his thing. And then you could buy a copy of his book.
And there won't be any fucking guitar playing.
Promises no guitar playing. So one of the things that's getting going again now is the Poets in Schools program that I started, and we have a real small sort of ragtag group until we're able to raise real funds, and until really all the schools know that we're here. I don't think they all know that we're here yet. It's just four of us total right now, and Tony doing a lot of the behind the scenes thing, and one of the people in the Poets in Schools program who's really taken it and run with it and just done beautiful work so far is our next reader, Mr. Jim Martin. Come on up, Jim.
Yeah, the Poets in the Schools program is really, really neat. It's 2 hours. 1 hour where you introduce the kids to poetry and have them write, and then 1 hour where they read. You can do more if you want, like I do a lot more. But you're planting seeds, and I know from years as a teacher that when you plant seeds, they actually do sprout in time, even if it's in a penitentiary. And I've had students that I've seen when I taught down there. I passed something on my walk down here, past what used to be the little Mozart preschool, and now it's a TAV, and there's a billboard out in front, and it says, education is important. Beer is importanter. I like that. I'm moving from my home that I lived in for a long time to an apartment that's just down the street. And I found this piece of paper with poems on it. And there's one by a woman named Adrienne R.I.C., and I think it's probably Adrienne Rich, but I'm not positive. When I read it, I had this 3D visual thing happen where there were these vague paths that just seemed to go off, and suddenly there was a bridge, and the bridge moved away from the page, and put those paths together. And so I want to read it again. You who think I find words for everything, this is enough for now. Cut it short, cut loose from my words. You for whom I write this, in the night hours when the wrecked cartilage sifts round the mystical jointure of the bones, when the insect of detritus crawls from shoulder to elbow to wrist bone, remember. The body's pain and the pain on the streets are not the same. But you can learn from the edges that blur. Oh, you who love clear edges more than anything, watch the edges that blur. I really like that.
Beautiful.
Okay, I read that, and I have two of my own. They're probably not really poems. A Rainy Night, if you know her, after the November Ghost Town Poetry, somebody said something about somebody could make it or maybe couldn't make it, and said something about a hole in there. I just can't remember the context now, I'm old. But Rainey said, if so-and-so was a hologram, I'd come to see him. And so it was about one of the Portland poets who come here often. And I couldn't remember which one, but I knew of the pair who come over here often, that it was probably one or the other of these two. So this one is titled, If Dennis Was a Hologram, I'd Come to See Him. The girl was over there by the streetlight. I don't know her, but something about her was familiar, her plaid wool shirt, I think. And the rant almost made me forget where I was or why. The rant was more a disconnected series of complaints about getting immigrants off the street, building a wall around the homeless shelter over by Lincoln. But I didn't have the time for endless rants. I had to make my flight to Denver to meet with the Swedish ambassador about the state of the salmon in Delaware. Thinking of myself, I stopped to take a look at myself, just curiosity to see what was there. I haven't looked for a long time, probably years, and she, the gypsy girl across the street, had stopped her rant, and her head was bent looking into herself. Must have been an optical illusion from the light, which was very bright by now. She is looking into herself at the same time I'm looking into my own self. My head tells me something isn't right here, so I take another look, deeper, very deep. And there, where I seem to shine the brightest, I find I am the girl across the street. But not a girl, I'm the man across the street, Dennis myself. A hologram of myself, me across the street, organized by some power to distract me. Somebody else, not me, expressing these thoughts. If they're the thoughts of the hologram of me, thoughts thought by the hologram, not me, but about me, are they really my thoughts? I'll walk the other way, give a shrug, and be on my way. After I'd walked half a block, I heard a splutter and looked back. The last of the hologram had just disappeared. Oh well. I hope I didn't displease you. And the other person was a guy named Michael. If Michael was a hologram, I'd come to see him. What's that dim glow? Yes! Over there! A shape! No! Shapes! Bright circle! Turning sparks in the air! Fading to dark background! A figure! Tall! Now hunched! Then all fours scurrying about! And words, long, loud, now terrifying, figure erect, full, arm raised, finger pierces the ceiling. Emphasis. What are his words? Sput, spat, sparks flash, figure, circle, sparkles, voice, dis, integrate. Electrical, short,
brings hologram performance to curtain.
Jim, I'm imagining you reading that to the second graders.
That's what it's all about.
It's in the school, watch out. I've been thinking a lot about trying to be hopeful and optimistic, not necessarily about the political stuff. It is what it is, and we'll see, but about losing our great poets, losing our friends. The passing of David Meltzer was just shocking and hit me like a ton of bricks. And I think that there's sort of all this, considering all that's been going on the last year and a half, sort of all this pent up, stored up emotion. And for me, it just came out uncontrollably when I heard that David had passed. And I was thinking that's maybe what happens to all of us, that it's hard to be in that high state of feeling on a daily basis because you have to get up and function in the world, right? So it tends to stack, and then when something happens and you just can't hold it back. And that there's something in that that we all share as human beings. So that's the only commentary I guess I can make on that. Anyway, I have an old poem that was finally finished, something I started quite a long time ago. It's a short one, but I couldn't quite figure out where I wanted to go with it. And then I've got some images based on growing up and in the 50s and 60s and just thinking about what life was like at that point in time. This one is called Behind Curtains. Just as men before him, proud to be working class, no alumni or conversations where family stock matters. Full-blown pride on bowling nights, beer on tap, team in first place, ball polished and ready for spares and strikes. Dependable always, she irons his shirt, sure that the mustard stains have disappeared and no buttons are AWOL. The following morning she makes the bed, then cleans the Brillo cream from his comb. Maybe there aren't people in here that remember Brillo cream. Oh, yeah. I do. I remember the commercial. They have two boys, both scouts. But she stops mid-step, remembers him saying, a girl would be fine. These are things you can't predict, like earthquake or relatives who drop by for Sunday dinner. Their happiness equals a lawn mowed on Saturday, a pot roast with potatoes, carrots, a peck on the cheek. Yet behind the curtains, a woman waits for her turn, a chance to be lifted to full potential. She remembers her first spelling bee when she brought home that fancy blue ribbon. It never made the trophy case reserved for Dad and her brothers. She kept it tucked in her sock drawer, brought it out when her sons asked what she did in school besides jumping rope. Now, too many dreams later, she puts Johnny Mathis on the record player as she dusts their trophies. He sings, Chances Are. And in the moment she twirls, sings along, thinks that one day, chances are, her time will come again. Now let's hear from Mr. Bruce Hall.
All right.
You don't have to go up on that one, Bruce.
way up.
I think it's fine. Yeah, it's fine. Okay. I wrote this one in Christopher's class last semester. Always great for prompts and keeps your writing and lots of creative juice in there. So always good to take his class. True knowledge. They burned books today. It was in front of Mrs. Grundy's house. Yeah, that crazy old hoarder lady's house. She had the last books on earth. The burning trended for as long as the smoke column climbed the sky. History books, they called some of them. Can you imagine? No wiki process to say what you thought. Those books held the first fake news. Language art books that taught how to match paper with pen. Paper's for burning, but what are pens? She had some books with bright pictures, a few words. They called them comic books, but they didn't make me laugh. The flames took them all. Think of the space those relics used up. We need more room for data centers. Data centers hold all the true knowledge. The birth of the internet, that's when real history started, way back in 1981. And I wrote this one in class too, but it wasn't one of Chris's prompts, and I don't know where the heck it came from. But, uncharacteristic for me, it's, I think it rhymes. Red alert, red alert, tonight is the night. The poets are in your town, tailgating before the open night. Clouds descend, you squirm, you see, hearing the gloom from the darkness. No, you cannot leave. You feel like a worm, memories bleed, left at the altar. This could be a good time to grieve. Haiku straight shots, tonka on draft, sonnet serves strong, setting you back. Simmering prose and embrace, tears don't hold back. Then the finale, a romp in the sack. Roped off floods? Did they pee their pants? CSI evidence of a Mike G rant. Are you brave enough? Are you tough enough? You had better care. The poets are tailgating and the time for the open mic is near.
Thanks, Bruce. And for anyone who was unable to come out to Poetry Moves celebration last weekend, Bruce has a wonderful poem on the buses. The new season of Poetry Moves, those poems, 12 of them, because they include the poem from the Washington State Poet Laureate and from Christopher. So now there are 12 of them on 180 buses in Clark County. So if you're riding a bus or you get a chance to look on the bus, you are going to see poems from our all of folks that won this time around. So congratulations, Bruce. And also, just as a side note, I loved Bruce's comment when he got up to the mic to read his poem, and he was really sharp, dressed, just it was so sharp. And he stood up there and he said, oh, well, in the president, this is, I'll paraphrase it, in the presidential election, and he had on a red tie. And he said, I guess, you know, this is the presidential look. But he said, the person who actually made this tie probably wouldn't, or the name on the back of the tie, probably wouldn't necessarily go along with what was going on. He said, the tie is made by Jerry Garcia. And it was great. So let's hear from another of our poets in the schools, teaching poets, Morgan Hutchinson. Morgan.
Thank you. Thanks for having the mic right here. That's perfect. I just, you know, we're on the same level, right?
Absolutely.
Thank you. I'd like to think I'm building on a theme here. Mike G's not in the room. But he did this earlier, and I would like to start my open mic out here with a simple gesture to the weather. He did this earlier. If everybody wants to join in, I would really appreciate that too. Gesture to the weather and probably many other things as well right now, right? Throw these up anytime you want to, okay? The first and only poem I'd like to share tonight is called Chapter One. I feel like this is the kind of, I'd like to maybe move this. I like the sign though, so let's keep the sign there. I like that. Okay, it's called Chapter One. A flowing fever. Inside forever, word fervor, ice shields, classic thought, and a subdued nature. We all gotta agree. When it gets this cold, there are necessary trials of fucking yourself, making memories, looking out the window, practicing dreaming, marrying freedom, not falling down, but okay with being hurt. Stale molds manifest the process, the transformation of ingenuity, ambition, shedding reptilian skin, and yearning for not giving a fuck, and then following through. Retaining walls, a sturdy structure made for natural disaster, a foundational statement. Emotions latent until later, and that becomes now. And the salt pours, the paper makes a point, moves on, resolves, restores, remains confident in the road taken. The moving on, so decided, void, and sordid. She's guilty of so much, but especially of seeing the signs but not acting on them. Reactive to, famous for, bad behavior, ego trips, controlling everything, missing everything, but still not sorry. Her eyes swollen, drifting, lessening consequence, improving pathways, learning how to transform, how to embrace the process, the present, the presence, the pretense, the premise, and pronoun, and perspective of change. They said goodbye without knowing what that meant. And now are sleeping in separate beds with separate water quality and heat functions with separate suburban views. They said goodbye. Unhinged the doors, each platform rounded out their character, listening to others. She nodded at the clouds, he nodded at the dirt, they both nodded at the clock, satisfying a certain thirst for outside learning, a softly authoritative knowing, and a freedom-induced first chapter. Thank you.
And next, we're going to hear from Scott Yeager. Come on, Scott.
Hey there, beautiful people. Let's do this. Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah. I want to first apologize to everyone that's read so far, because I feel like I haven't been a very good listener. I've been really distracted. There's this picture over here of Christopher with his shirt off doing this, and it's just like, my eyes are just glued to that thing, so. And also this sign, which I really love it, but I'm trying to like, wait, does this really apply to me? Like, what if you're like, smell like combusted marijuana and tobacco and hippie stink? Like, is that really okay here too?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Gratitude? Fuck you, gratitude. Yeah, sure, whatever. I am grateful for having the privilege to take it all for granted. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to have relationships and then shitting all over my fantastic expectations. Thank you for filling my life with material wealth, whether I want it or not, but still have to feel a bit guilty about it. Or do I, really? Thanks for all the cool stuff there is to do if I just ride my bike 10 to 25 miles through freezing rain, aggro drivers, and clouds of toxic car exhaust. Thanks for not making life too easy on me because I already worry too much that I just parade around like a spoiled brat, And thanks for the clear path of ascent into the world's wealthiest 1%, no matter how hell-bent I am on squandering it, wandering on into a wealth of poetic poverty. This one has a name, it's called Dual Currents. Smashing dichotomies, I arrange the pieces carefully into two piles, categorically, right, left, light, heavy, white, and dark. But one slips, flows from my grip, floats, falls, flies, uninhibited, its form amorphous, shape-shifting, nameless, meaning, mysteries, purpose. And windy, drifting, droplets lifting, just juggling you, my beloved, tossed above it, reachless, dove, flits. Air encounters air, so they say, where storm brews, over there, river pays, no mind, accepts influx in time, passes on my ride. This one is called How I Feel When I Can't Go to the Ghost Town Poets Open Mic, because when the apocalypse finally came, it started as 8 inches of snow. We'd all been waiting, not knowing what to expect, accepting the end of an era. 2 steps forward, burn the bridge. Thanks, Obama. Anthropogenicized catastrophic climate destabilization, which extinction are we calling this? Again, it seems change breeds conflict, or a graceful rebalancing, like standing on 1 foot for eternity. What's going to happen in this life? Where am I headed? Tracks in the snow, these just oblong points, those lines fanning unknown, previously unseen deviations from my straight and narrow path. Failures not missed, opportunities recognized as such, and thus better than unmissed longings singing on. We were one big mess of pieces of paper, of trees or brown leaves rolled up in such or stuffed glad bags. In the morning, there wasn't much left of ourselves, of us. With me, everything is meaning, some specific thing hard to find. Even harder is keeping up with that, not even caught up to. Don't forget the strangeness, don't give up on your softness. The only thing that freedom lacks, said the kid on the street, is the certainty of being bound up to something outside of yourself. Man, I can't wait to leave home. Thanks.